Hello, everyone. Welcome to our presentation of the director and cast. If you would help me welcome Dorie Barton, the director of Girl Flu. Also, we have with us tonight Jade Pettyjohn, who played Bird. Diego Josef, who played Carlos. And Heather Matarazzo, who played Lily. So good to be with you guys again. This is my fourth time leading a Q&A here, and I just love coming. My name is Chris Krebsbach, and I am a film instructor at the Los Angeles Film Studies Center, which is right down the street. And it's good to be here with you guys tonight. But if we could just start by you guys introducing yourselves and just tell us a little brief history of you, how you came up, what you've been. Yeah, we'll just start with you and go down the line.
I'm Dorie Barton. I'm the writer and director of Girl Flu. Thank you. I've been an actor my whole life. I stepped on stage when I was 7, and I totally fell in love with it. I've done theater my whole life. I went to CalArts to study acting, and I've worked in film and television pretty steadily since then until several years ago. I decided that I would never really be happy until I turned it around and got on the other side of the camera. So I wrote this film and then I directed it. That's it.
Great, thanks.
Hi guys, I'm Jade.
Thanks.
I play Bird, as you might have noticed. I'm 16. I've been acting for 10 years now. I also started when I was 7. Yeah, and I also fell in love with it. It's kind of a beautiful art form. Really is easy to fall in love with it. I've been working. We shot this film in 2014. That's it.
Hi, I'm Diego Josef. I'm 16 years old, same as Jade. I fell in love with acting when I watched Zack and Cody, so that was like my dream to be on that show. So that was really cool. Also, my dad was an actor, so that was cool. He inspired me to do that. But I had a really amazing experience working on this film. Dorie was a great director, and Jade was amazing. All you guys were amazing. It was great.
Oh, your little hand is shaking.
It's nerve-wracking.
I know.
Yeah, it's really.
I know. Without a character to hide behind. I'm Heather Matarazzo. I played Lily. I too started when I was 7. Yeah. I'm like, we should go to a casino, try our luck at the slots. I've been a member of the Screen Actors Guild now for over 20 years. And there's nothing better than getting to be a storyteller and work with incredible people and, you know, especially getting to work with women directors, which I hope I get to do more and more.
Yeah, so Dorie, what was kind of the inspiration for you starting to make the shift into writing and directing, and then why this as your first film?
I went through a weird phase several years ago where my agent sent me out for maybe 10 auditions in a row for Cougars. And that didn't really sit well with me. And I called him and he was so sweet about it. He was like, well, we don't really know what else to do with you. Like, you're not really a lawyer. I don't really look like a mom to Hollywood, you know. Anyway, I guess not wanting to be a Cougars kind of what motivated me to
great, yeah,
to do this.
Seems understandable. And was this a story that was kind of rolling around in your mind for a while, or did it just pop in, or how did that come about?
It kind of arrived as a whole actually, and then it kind of took me some time to figure out how to get down what was in my mind. I'd written before, I'd written with a partner before. This was very personal to me. But yeah, the idea came into my mind of wanting to explore what it's like to get your period for the first time, and that's so often used in films as a really crass joke, or as a way to really just humiliate the girl or gross out the boy. Like that's really all it's ever used for. So I felt like it was a story that was really worth telling in depth. And you know, Jade and I talked about it a lot. Every day yeah. of her period is a totally different experience and a different intention on her part. And I felt like this was really worth an entire film, and it was. Yeah. You told the story beautifully.
Thank you.
So this question is from the audience. I'm going to incorporate some of these as we go through. This is from Christine. What challenges did you experience as a director of your own writing?
Yeah, well, you got to defend that stuff every time. Every time you do a scene, you know, it's to shift hats is interesting. To, you know, to go off and have a conversation with the writer when you need to think about it is that's tricky, or really convenient. Maybe it's convenient. Just facing the reality of, I think this particular film is it's not a really deliberate traditional structure. It's different in that the goal isn't necessarily, you know, it's not Die Hard. She's not, you know, it's not Christmas Eve and she's against terrorists and she got to get out of the building. Like, it's not a really super straightforward masculine story like that. I love Die Hard. It's my favorite movie. But but this is not that. Yeah, I really love Die Hard. So as a writer, you know, that was really intentional from the script. But facing it as a filmmaker is a different situation. That was challenging to constantly imbue it with a sense of her going after a goal and her having conflict, even when the conflict looks different than it does in Die Hard.
Great, thanks. how long did it take you to write the script, would you say?
I think it was about a year and a half from when I sat down and wrote my cards to when I felt like it was ready to go out.
And so then can you share with us a little bit about the process from the writing stage, how you started to build your team, get producers, and how long that whole process took?
It was really fast once I found a producer. It was actually, I believe it was in June, and then we shot in the middle of November? End of November. So it all happened really quickly once it happened. The hard part was waiting to find the right partners, and then, you know, having the patience and perseverance to believe in myself and believe that this was a story worth telling, and finding allies who were equally as enthusiastic as I was and believed in it.
Great. So you get to casting, and you start to find these delicious people that fit together in the cast so perfectly. I mean, really, I just think your ensemble is so strong. Talk about that process. Like, how did you guys come on to the project? Was it completely a traditional casting process? Were you making offers? What was the process like for the three of you as well coming onto the film?
It was kind of a normal audition process. I got an email from my agent saying that I had an audition come up, and I remember reading the synopsis for this and like completely burst out laughing because it's so true, and I was like so out of nowhere. I hadn't heard about a film in this way talking about this topic. And then I read the full script and I thought it was beautiful. I thought it was so truthful, and I think that the way that it was written was done in such a real and raw way, but it has like a sense of humor to it as well, which I really enjoyed. And then I went in, I auditioned, got a call back, and met Dorie. We talked about music in it, and we just like got to know each other as well, which is a little bit different from other auditions and callbacks. And then I booked it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got the script, same as Jade. It was really fun. It was really cool. I really enjoyed it. I was really scared, though, for when the skateboarding part, though, because I didn't really know how to skateboard. And when I was seven, I was had a skateboard accident, and I knocked the wind out of me. But yeah, it was really fun, though. I had an amazing time learning and reading the script, and it was really fun. It was pretty good.
Thank you.
It was really good.
Thanks, Diego.
Yeah, and I got the script and I read it, and then we met in a coffee shop in
Echo Park.
I always confuse Eagle Rock and Echo Park. Again, we had like a 3.5 hour conversation. Like we talked and talked and talked and talked. You know, and for me, most times, except when I have bills to pay, you know, I'm very selective about the material that I say yes to, you know, and attach my name to. And Dorie is very unique in regards to she has a natural vulnerability that is also coupled with this beautiful fiery energy, you know, and her passion just inspired me, you know, and I knew that I was going to be in safe hands, and I trusted the story, I trusted her, you know, and why the fuck not, you know?
That's a glowing
thank you.
Talk a little bit more about, you guys all have pretty extensive acting resumes. So what did you experience working with a director who had such a strong acting background that maybe you've not experienced in the past with other directors you've worked with?
I think one thing about working with Dorie that was a new experience for me and I thought was really great was she comes from a theater background. And so before we started production, she would come over to my house and we would have rehearsals. And I had no idea what to do with time to rehearse about it. So we would sit on my couch and we would have our scripts out with our little pen and pencils and we would just talk about it and talk and talk and talk, and we would create backstories and figure out stories with different objects and Bird's relationship with every person in the script, and that was amazing for me. We created a little universe for Bird, and that was very different from something that, yeah, just very different for me.
It was so fun.
It was really fun. Yeah.
We had a lot of cheese.
We had a lot of cheese.
Oh, thank you.
We did. My mom had like a little cheese snack platter going on.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. But with that too, like I'll say, it's such an interesting question, like an actor's director. I would hope that every director is an actor's director in regards to if you are, you know, going to be an effective storyteller and an effective director, and you are dealing with other human beings, you are going to know how to talk to them in a way to get the performance that you need. And with that too, like, and this is a difference that I find a lot of times between male directors and female directors. I'm gonna go here.
That's why you're here. Take us there, Heather.
You know what? You never came from a place of ego because it wasn't about you needing to look important or feel powerful. And you let us as actors have room to explore and be. And you trusted us enough to do our jobs that really beautiful, unexpected things came as a result. So the authentic moments that we got to have, the honest moments that we got to have, were because it was about the story. It was about telling the story that involved people and relationships and the complexities of those relationships and coming up against yourself and coming up against, you know, society in the outside world, and what is it to be a woman? What is it to be a person? You know, a socioeconomic background, everything, you know, and most directors I find don't do that because they are more concerned about being in power than they are about telling an effective story.
Thanks.
Good answer. I really enjoyed working with Dorie. She was amazing. She had so much passion for this movie, and every day she just came with so much energy to set. And she was very, like she said, she would let us be free with our roles, and she let us make our own decisions a lot, and she was really cool.
And you did take a really bad fall on the skateboard.
I did. They had to put a butt pad on me.
It makes me sick when I see that in the film. Every time it just makes me sick to my stomach to see you fall. I worry about your knees.
Yeah.
Thank you for doing that. It needed to happen, and you did it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Feel the collaborative spirit up here. So I would venture a guess that most of the people in the room listening are actors. So demystify the process a little bit of the casting process. What were you looking for as the director? Did you have a super clear understanding of who you're looking, or were you open? How did that process go for you in the casting process, trying to find the right people for these roles?
In every case, it was a completely gut response. I wish I could demystify it with some logic or some framework to put against it, or say that I had, you know, an idea in my mind and they happened to fit. Like, it wasn't the case. In some way, I don't know. Oftentimes what I go into a situation with, you know, I have some kind of expectation, and I'm almost always wrong when the actual thing happens. But what happens is I can no longer remember what I expected, because whatever's happening is so much better than I could have ever expected, because it's what's happening. And so I think in some ways casting was like that for me. Like, if I did have an expectation in my mind, it was eradicated when I saw these people walk in the room. And it just, there, you know, the minute I saw Jay, there was no one else but her. When the minute I saw Diego, there was no one else but him. Heather, she's Lily. The second I heard her voice, she's Lily, you know. So it's not magical, but it's not logical.
I'm just really impressed, given the fact that you are a writer director, that you seem to have held things very loosely in terms of your own vision on the page, kind of from what you're saying. So how much did the script change based on your actors and what they were bringing to the table and the conversations you were having, let's say, with Jade or other people in the cast? Were there shifts?
I remember talking, there isn't a lot of shifts. I think there's two moments in the film that I think was something that we created. I remember that we were talking about the clinic scene where Bird wants to get her tubes tied, and I had this idea of just walking in there and picking up like a herpes pamphlet and just being completely terrified, and so that ended up making it in.
Yeah.
And the scene with Arlo and Bird right before we go in to have the talk, in my bed, that was all improv. The camera just started rolling on us, and we just, you know, embraced the awkwardness of it, and then, yeah, so that changed.
Didn't call cut.
Yeah, you didn't call cut, so we were just like, okay, great, we'll continue on with this.
There's so much amazing footage I'm so sorry, between Heather and Katie, like, I could make a whole film about their relationship and them hanging out and dishing and smoking weed. And there was, like, some whole story you made up about some, like, lesbian party about, like, old...
Really?
Crazy, yes. Oh, I should show you the footage sometime.
I would love to see it.
Like, old lesbians are, like, old... It's hysterical. but, yeah, there's, I mean... so much of the improvisation is just amazing. The film is, I guess it's close to what it was on the page, by and large. It was a good guiding point, I think, for us. And I think it did kind of, by sticking to the script, I think it made us maybe feel a little bit more free to explore in other ways.
Yeah, I don't think that the script, at least in my opinion, when I read the script, there wasn't anything that needed to be forced or changed about it. I feel like the way that it was written was just kind of beautiful. And as an actor, I just didn't want to mess the words up because I thought that they were perfect, you know? I didn't feel like I needed to overact it or overcompensate in some kind of way because it was just there. And then we have little moments like, you know, with Arlo and Bird, but there wasn't much changing, I think, you know, as an actor's standpoint. I thought that it was just already there. Yeah.
And Jade, this is another question from our audience, from Ned. When you first read the script, how did you start mentally preparing it, and what were the biggest challenges of playing Bird?
Good question. When I first read the script, I was surprised and shocked, and I kept laughing because there's so much truth in it. You know, and as a girl, when you're reading it, you go, oh my gosh, I do that, and that happens too. And so I was really trying to kind of bridge my life and Bird's life. You know, Bird and I are similar, but we're very different at the same time. We come from different backgrounds. I did not have a relationship like she did with her mom. You know, my mom's a lot more responsible. and so there was a lot of differences, and so I wanted to put my own truth and my own kind of reality into Bird, but at the same time create and mock up her life and try and get understanding for her world too, and just trying to bridge that, I think, was the first thing I was trying to do when I was reading it, you know. Create reality with the entire thing. Yeah.
So you guys have been doing really great on the festival circuit, it seems. I was reading some of your press, and you opened at LA Film Fest, which is a feat in itself, so congratulations. But I was curious as to, this is a very female-driven project about a very female subject. How are you being received on the festival circuit? Are you seeing that it's a pretty wide audience is relating to the film, or how... And has that been surprising to you, or kind of talk about how it's been received by people who've seen it?
It's been received well. The only thing that I can't say if I was surprised, I really hoped that men would see that it was, that the story is for them too, and that they have a role in it. And that men can be our allies and help us grow and help us see ourselves. It's a very female story, you know, to the bone. It's for women, it's about women, it's about our lives, our biological lives, you know, and our emotional lives. But the male characters in it were very important to me. Like, it was very important to me that Carlos was a very real person with layers and sisters. but the women have been wonderful, and the reception from women has just been, I've been really overwhelmed with how open women have been to me and the stories that they come up and they share. I've heard some stories. So I wouldn't say I'm surprised. I'm very grateful. I'm really, really grateful for how open-hearted everyone has been. There's something about this film that's certainly greater, far greater than I am, bigger than all of us in many ways. It seems to tap into something with people that just, I don't know, it's certainly bigger than gender, which has been really wonderful to see. So yeah, I'm really grateful.
What were the, this is for everybody, either your most challenging scene, or we are watching a movie about teenage awkwardness, so maybe some of the more awkward moments on set while you were filming.
Okay.
Well, for me, the most challenging scene was probably the kiss scene, because that was like my first ever kiss, so I was like really nervous about that. But yeah, that was the most challenging scene for me.
Your first take, you looked like you were trying to headbutt her. No.
She told me 3 seconds, I just went in and did a little like bird pecking and just bumped.
Yeah, yeah, out. Yeah. No, we ended up having to. I was like, you gotta do 5 seconds. You gotta stay in there.
She's like, Diego, what did I say? I was like, 3 seconds.
And it's great. It's a really good. It's everybody it's good. Loves. I mean, it's a great scene.
Yeah, I think, I don't know. In my opinion, the story may feel awkward, you know, what we're dealing with can be some very awkward, uncomfortable things, but I think because of that, everything was so much more comfortable, because everything was out in the open. So, you know, like, yeah, you yeah. really could talk about anything, and so I think it really was a free space. And yeah, we did create some awkwardness, but even that was free. I don't think that really the atmosphere on set was inhibited at all. We would be laying down on the couch and Dorie would be eating the yogurt french fry thing, and we would just be talking and about periods and boys and things and whatever, right? You know, we were just talking about everything. It just didn't feel very restricted in any way.
So many tampons and pads around the set, just for props. And it was so heartwarming for me when, like, the grips would be like, here's a tampon. Like, oh,
yeah.
Loved it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm just so glad I asked that question. When all is said and done and you guys watch this film back, what are your favorite moments of the film?
I think
kissing.
Aww,
it's a good scene.
It was a good scene.
It's a really good scene.
You did good. I don't know. I like seeing everything as a whole. I tend to get a little bit sentimental almost on the scene right before we go to the fire station, that fight scene, because that particular day was probably one of my favorite days acting, because we come in, my call time was like 7:30 or something, and the first scene is something really simple. I don't even remember what it was, but it was very simple and easy. Then the next scene we did was the comedy fight scene where I'm slapping her and I'm like, you're gonna be a creepy grandma, and you know, so that was good. And then we went to this scene, and I was nervous for it. I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know what was gonna happen. I was like, do I bring tears? How do I do this? As an actor, I was kind of getting in my head a little bit. And you know, Katie and I, we enter into the scene. So we were sitting on the front porch waiting for Dorie to say action, and it just, something hit. I looked at Katie and she was holding the purple tampons, and she was in it, and she was just there prepared, and I was there, and we just suddenly clicked, and we were in Jenny and Bird's universe, and then it just, everything was so easy and free, and like just nothing, there was no barrier or restriction, and so we went in and it just was raw, and that felt amazing. I left set saying, this is exactly what I'm doing in my life for the rest of my life. That was really gratifying. So that was a pretty great scene.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
What's your?
I mean, I don't know.
You don't like your pulling up the underwear?
No, well, I was thinking. I mean, I like, for me, I'm just grateful that A, anybody calls me ever. But B, you know, I just love getting to work with people that are as passionate about storytelling as I am, you know, and I guess there's that scene, but also, that scene in the bedroom, and that scene on the front porch, that's really tender, and it's really beautiful, and it's just a moment. And it's such an honest moment. You know, it really, this film, I think, is just like a series of honest moments, you know, and I worked with Katie predominantly, you know, and there's nothing better than getting to work with a fellow actor that is able to meet you and match you. And is willing to go there and is willing to play and is willing to explore. And you know, that was my experience, you know, so I loved getting to do every part of it. My least favorite part was probably like the big backyard scene. Just because I hate being sticky.
You hate being sticky.
I know.
So real honey then.
It was real honey.
Okay. Real milk.
It was weird. I actually.
It was real milk even.
It was real milk, real honey. It was very strange. I mean, it's a first experience. But it was, what was funny was that day we had that whole scene. And I was doused in milk and honey, and then I go to my first audition for School of Rock, which is the series I'm on now.
That's a good plug.
And I just thanks. Yeah, put that in.
You had to go right from Sessa
right
to the,
from oh, there. And I just so remember sorry. When I was in the audition, I was just like, I smell like milk and I smell like honey, and it kept going into my head that I was like,
and
oh,
that's why
they're
you
gonna
got
know.
The job.
And yeah,
that's exactly why you got the job.
I owe it to the honey. Yeah,
and the milk.
Is it the milk and the honey?
Honey and milk.
Smell? It doesn't smell good after a while. It's nice
after
at first,
a while,
and then
it's, yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know.
You were such a trooper. It was so gross.
It's a first experience, man. It's an adventure.
How about you, Dorie? Any favorite moments of
the
film?
Oh, God, no, the whole thing. I'm crazy about it.
I figured.
I can't pick a moment. Although I just do have to say, too, like, to express gratitude for, you know, the entire cast, who's just phenomenal and so willing to play. Just so grateful to my producers, so grateful to all of my, you know, the key people that made this happen. Our DP, Alice Brooks, did astonishing work. I'm just all of this is just it is a true collaboration of every, you know, that every single moment to me when I watch it, I see, you know, like, oh, that's the prop that she made, and oh, those are the, you know, that's the curtains that we found, and I remember when all of us thought up the thing to do with that, you know, just it's a whole, all the stories behind the story to me are so prevalent to me when I see any piece of this footage.
So what are we looking for you guys in next, or what's the next project for you?
Oh, I'm
please, anybody.
Please go.
Well, I'm currently filming the third season of School of Rock. Yeah, it's fantastic. Thank you. Yeah, no, it's been a great experience. I've really been able to explore and play with comedy, which has been really fun. And so we're doing the third season right now. I have a film coming out with Johnny Depp and J.K. Simmons and Sam Raimi for Make a Film Foundation. That'll be coming out soon, which is, I'm really excited about it. And then the rest is out in the open. You never know. As an actor, you never know what's coming around the corner, so you just wait, I guess.
I have a film coming out. It just premiered. Is in South by Southwest. It's called The Ballad of Lefty Brown. It's with Bill Pullman and Jim Caziviel and Peter Fonda. But yeah, it was really fun. I got to shoot in Montana and play a cowboy and dress up and shoot with guns and spin them. It was really cool. It was really fun. Yeah.
I know. I just completed a film called Stuck that was directed by another woman, Jillian Aramonte. And we're in post-production right now, so it's like myself and Joe McHale and Felicia Day, Kate Flannery, Paul Scheer. And we're looking to raise funds for post-production. So you can go to www.stuckfeature.com to help, because it's actually like a really fucking awesome film. And I just launched my podcast called Shut Up and Listen, which is really, really awesome. And then I'm getting ready to direct my first short this summer.
Congratulations, that's great.
And I'm writing the next one.
Yay. All right, last question of the night. What is the biggest thing that you are taking away, that you took away from this experience working on this film? Or one of them.
Probably be a good guy to like your woman stuff.
Nice.
I mean, like Arl. Like Arl did a good job of that. I mean, he wasn't like too pushy, but he was like, he was in that spot. He was good. He was a good husband. And Carlos, I mean, he made sure Jade was happy and Jade was comfortable, and he didn't go like too far with it. But yeah, he made sure she was okay. It was really fun.
That's an awesome takeaway.
That's really like it.
Yeah, be good to your woman. That's brilliant. Yeah,
thank you.
One moment. Oh, okay. One thing. I think that this film represents a lot for me. You know, I really, really broke a lot of barriers as an actor, and I'm gonna carry that with me for the rest of my career. It'll keep growing and keep learning from that. But I think something about this film in particular that I just love is that it takes a topic that for some reason has taboo around it or is controversial in film for some random reason, because it's, I don't know, whatever. But it takes that and then it, I don't know, it makes it real for people, you know what I mean? It's something that's so real, and it's just a normal part of life. It's not something that should be glorified or vilified or anything. It's just a part of life and growing up, and I think that that's what I took away most from it. So yeah.
thanks guys.
I mean, I took him a paycheck.
Yeah,
yeah, it was huge. Love indie film. Anyways, no, really just it, I think that it can be very, because I've been doing this now for almost 30 years as an actor, and I can only, I think that it can get very hard as an actor, especially, you know, in this town, this industry, to keep the love and the passion, you know, and it starts to lose its, you know, zhuzh, and it becomes more about having to pay bills, and the auditions become about a need, you know, and the playing is lost, the fun is lost, the magic is lost, you know? And also, there are so many fucking assholes that just take all the fun out of it. You know, they forget that it's like a privilege and an honor to be able to tell stories, you know, that it's a gift that we get to do what we do. So what I took away from this, aside from the fact that like I love working with female directors or directors that happen to be women. How many times can I say that? Because it really needs to be said so many more. But that, what I took away from it in all seriousness is that it was the first time in a long time that I felt, I don't want to use the word respected, because that went without saying, not in an egotistical way. Appreciated as an actor. You know, that it wasn't just me feeling like a human prop having to stand on a mark and saying a line. You know, I felt appreciated as an actor, and that the conversations were valid. And Dorie took suggestion, and she gave us room. And I feel more and more these days that is harder and harder to come by, you know? So it was the revitalization that I needed at the time in order to be like, okay, maybe I won't hang up my hat just yet. So that's what I took away from it.
Don't hang your hat up. Don't ever hang that hat up.
Does anyone still wear a hat?
That's very hard for me to say any one thing. I think the work is deeply important to me, that there is something to show for it is deeply important to me. Having done theater my whole life and, just weeping on closing night when the set gets torn down. It was really wonderful for me to have this experience of building something that I can still see and I can go back and I can remember these moments and remember that day on set or remember when we came up with that backstory or remember when we crawled into bed together and talked about that one line for like an hour and how joyful that was and, you know, just all these beautiful things and there's something to show for it. So I feel very proud of all of our work in this and it's, I'm very, you know, it's there. It exists.
Well, congratulations again, and let's thank our panel one more time.
Thank you.
Thanks.